Hey everybody, it's Mr. Buro from Staten Island Tech, and today I'm going to show you how to draw a wall in Revit, which is one of the most essential tools. In addition to that, I'm going to also show you how to draw a reference plane, which can be used in conjunction with drawing walls, as well as other things. So what you're looking at here is a standard interface. I'm on a level one floor plan, which is a two-dimensional space. What you see on the top is the ribbon of commands. Over here in the architecture tab, you'll see that there are two types of walls to be drawn, an architectural and a structural wall. We're gonna stick with architectural walls because they have no designation to be structural. We don't really wanna think about that right now because of the complexity that comes with viewing things such as structural walls and architectural walls at the same time. So let's stick with architectural walls and worry about structure later. After I click the architectural wall button, you can see the ribbon changes quite a bit. We have this gray area over here, which is known as the modify tab. Over here, it says it right here. But in addition to that, there's a place wall options. So everything that appears in green is context sensitive for the drawing of walls. But the stuff that appears in gray is typically what would appear during any command that involves creation inside Revit. As you can see, to draw the walls, I have quite a few options here. I could draw them with a line, a rectangle, two types of polygons, inscribed and circumscribed. I could draw circular walls, walls from arcs of two different types. I could modify existing pieces to do fillets and use tangent functions. And I could draw elliptical walls, and I could use a really fun command called pick lines to help me draw walls from existing pieces, as well as pick faces. On the bottom of the ribbon, very important options here. These are the different things that I have to choose while I'm creating the wall. First of all, by default, I'm creating a wall based on its center. It's going to be 20 feet high and unconnected. If I want, I would want to connect it to one of the existing level markers. And currently I'm drawing the wall on level one. So if I'm drawing the wall on level one and leaving it unconnected, that means I'm not gonna say how high it is other than saying it's unconnected height. Usually though, we'd like to reference a different level here and force it to be able to be changed as we modify the heights of the levels. I have the chain option selected, which means when I draw walls, it's gonna continue drawing them head to toe. Currently, it's not being offset from where my mouse is, otherwise I could change that. I'm not going to connect them with any radii, and I'm going to allow all walls that are drawn to be joined together. Let me zoom in a bit over here. I'm going to start drawing right around here, but before I put one click of my wall down, I'm going to switch the type of wall with the type selector from generic to something as an exterior wall. Let me pick the brick on metal stud wall because it's a very simplistic brick exterior. After I select it, I'm gonna go and click somewhere in the drawing space. And as you can see, as soon as I click, we have some information popping up on the screen. We have the length of the wall as well as the direction that it's going in reference to the x-axis, which is the standard 0 degree mark for all CAD programs. I'm gonna make this wall 20 feet long, click it, and then I'll be clicking, let's say 20 feet to the right as well. As you could see, it's a jagged edge in that corner, but once I place it down, that corner has been formed perfectly. I'm gonna go ahead and end that command. Right now, what you can see on the screen is pretty generic, so I'm gonna change the detail level down to fine, so I can see the different wall layers and also turn on the coloring of consistent color. Consistent color is like a simplistic way of looking at something, but still colored. Okay. So as you can see, I have the brick parts facing north and west, which can be changed. If I click on the wall and then click on this orientation button, I can make the bricks appear eastward and south as well. That button is also on the keyboard as the space bar. That's called the orientation switching of the wall. I'm going to continue drawing now. As you can see, there's a lot of snaps that appear on the screen before I even click anywhere. Now that I have two objects on the screen, I can bring my mouse and we'll see that there's extension snaps coming outward from any direction. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to snap it onto that wall endpoint. And remember, I'm allowing joining and chaining, so this will continue to draw walls that are connected to each other. I can also draw diagonally, and as you can see, I have all these snaps still popping up. If I wanted to extend this wall to where the other wall began or ended, I could use that extension snap. I could bring it down here to activate that extension snap if I wanted to. Those things also come alive with angles. And as in addition to those snaps that are in reference to other objects, I could just reference normal snaps, like that would be 45 degrees or so. So I can make this 8 feet long at that downward 45 degree angle, another 8 feet outward, and then 8 feet upward. And as you can see, it's very, very quickly snapping into place wherever I would like it to be. It's interesting how everything joins together very nicely, even if it was drawn in a very weird way. And here, as you can see, I'm just stopping right there at that snap. That's enough for now. So as you can see, I used the line tool and I created some vertical and horizontal lines as well as some diagonally facing lines. If I wanted to continue from there drawing, let's say an arc, I can go ahead and click right here as my endpoint. Now I'll pick another endpoint for my arc, let's say down here. And I could go ahead and change the angle at which the arc makes with certain snaps as well, which is very convenient. Switching back to linear if I want to. With even an angle connection there. As you can see though, the orientation of these walls doesn't match. So I can click it and press the space bar and flip it over. So the walls will have the bricks on the exterior. Let's take a quick look at see what this looks like in 3D. Here is all of the walls. If I go in close, you can see the brick faces. Right now they're 20 feet high. So if I showed you that level 2 began at 10 feet, but then I went down to a side view, you could see that they're well above that particular marker. So what I would want to do is I'd want to click on one of the walls and change its top constraint to up to level 2. And as you could see, that wall now aligns perfectly with the top of level 2. And should I change where level 2 ends, it's connected to it indefinitely. I'm going to go ahead and select all of the walls and make them top constrained to level 2. Other things that you would see inside that property area, we have whether it's beginning at the base or ending at the top. So if I go to 3D here, click, and I change the base offset a foot, you can see it actually raises a foot off the ground. And I could change the top offset to -1 foot, and you can see it will go down 1 foot from the top as well. So that's if I wanted to shorten the top or shorten the bottom, I can go ahead and do that. Positive and negative values work just fine. Other things you will see up here, changing, of course, whether it's constrained to the base or not. Top constraint, its home location is known as the base constraint. Whether or not it will be eventually defining what a room would be, if it's going to be structural, as well as several other very, very detailed options that you could have. Let's go back to the creation process. Now, as you can see, I have a bunch of walls already here. If I go ahead and right click here, I'm going to pick create similar. We'll go back to creating normal walls. And instead of using a line command, I want to show you how you can make it using a pick lines command instead. There's this really cool tool here called Pick Lines, which allows you to pick an existing place to create a wall. But if I pick it right now, it'll build it on top of what I have, which is not good. Instead, what I'd like to do is I would like to change this offset to 5 feet. And now I'm gonna measure from this exterior face a little bit, but I don't wanna draw here, I wanna draw to also an exterior face. So if I do this, it'll create exactly 5 feet in between this exterior face and that exterior face. And I can actually change that orientation. So there's exactly 5 feet in between. That was nice. I could also do that in a circular way where there's 5 feet of space. Again, you can see how it connected perfectly here. Do that again over here. And then over here. And then over here. And as you can see, it connects perfectly to have this 5 foot walkway in between those two walls. So that's using the pick lines command in conjunction with offset in creation of the wall. In addition to that, I'm gonna go back to architecture and pick reference plane. Reference planes are created in a similar way. You draw them with lines. So if I draw a line here, it's just a marker basically that's off from a particular wall. And I could bring that inside, or it can run at a diagonal or something like that if I wanted to. I could just draw another reference plane that runs, let's say, parallel to that, well, not parallel, but like kind of as an extension of the wall over there. And I can go ahead and create a new wall, which is be kind of weird, but let's say I go to create a new wall, but I can go ahead and kind of snap it along that reference plane at the intersection. And it's a little bit tough to make a join, but I'm sure that if I worked at this a little bit, there we go, I can get it to join perfectly. And it's an exterior wall, so it doesn't really make sense to be on the inside. But if I changed it to an interior wall, just like so, it would connect perfectly along with that line. And I could even align it if I wanted to using the align command. Actually, I missed. There you go. That's pretty simple on how to do that. So reference planes, you can give them names. Like I can call this like a midline reference line. And it just has a name. And if I could now use that, if I wanted to create some interior wall that are opposite there. Yeah, so interior wall. Offset 2 feet from a center, and I'll use pick lines, and I'll just pick this particular line right here. So I've created it offset 2 feet left and 2 feet right of that reference plane. I can continue making them 2 feet apart from each other if I want as well. That's a really convenient feature. The joining of walls occurs automatically, as I was saying before. So if I wanted to create like top parts over here, or like a middle part in between some of them, I can go ahead and do that very easily. If I click on the wall, I could press up or down to shift all of the walls together because they are joined together. It's a really, really powerful way of handling things. So we've done quite a bit. We've looked at both the 2D and 3D view of all the stuff that we've been creating. I used reference planes, so a lot of the snaps that are dynamic. We looked at the properties, you know, the constraints and all that stuff. In the creation process, we saw all sorts of tools that are there for drawing walls. Like if I were to draw something that would be polygonal, it's very easy. And again, if it intersects, it'll do all the appropriate joining that's necessary. That's really good. In a way where you can make anything you want inside Revit, as long as you know how to use the tools correctly. So that's drawing walls, and that's using reference planes, and kind of like using them in conjunction with each other. There's a lot more to it for sure, but that should be a good place for you to get started. And don't be afraid to explore. Thank you very much.